papers from both campus and the community together with authors from the Magnes collection. And we sort of, it's an experiment. Every week we see what happens. And we cover very different topics. Today is a really a particular honor to welcome to the stage Erin Faigin. Erin approached us at the Magnes over 2 years ago as part of the, it's a funky acronym, the URAP, Undergraduate Research Apprentice Program. It's a way for undergraduate students to come and do research with us. And we, every semester, have somewhere between 6 and 10 undergrads who work on various parts of the collection. And it was an easy fit since Erin manifested very early on in her career as an undergraduate her interest in Yiddish to have her work with Yiddish materials. I had just completed an inventory together with a graduate student of about 90 volumes in Yiddish that were printed in California. And Erin was like the fastest person to learn how to catalog books. It was like second nature to her, but also the topic itself really inspired her. And she developed it as her own digital project as part of the Digital Humanities here at the Magnes. So what we have now online is a digital map, Yiddish map of Los Angeles, that she created, as she will explain, by tracking down the addresses of where all the books were printed or written. And it's a fantastic contribution. And you would think she stopped there, but of course, no, she didn't stop there. She's been now cataloging Yiddish sheet music and more. She's been really doing fantastic work with us. She's a wonderful colleague to all of us and really a great asset. So it's just one of those moments where everything that we do here really comes together. It all sort of, you know, those magical moments where things make sense. And I just leave the floor to Erin. Please give her a warm welcome.
Hi, is this too loud? Can everyone hear me? Okay, so I'm just gonna let you guys know there are like 3 things I'm gonna touch on today. One of which is the digital humanities and looking at how that helps us illuminate the Yiddish history of Los Angeles. I'm also going to talk about East LA and their Yiddish history and sort of debunk the myths of Boyle Heights as Los Angeles's Lower East Side. And finally, I'm going to look at West LA and their Yiddish community and their literary publications and sort of uncover the hidden literary history of Los Angeles. So first, a little bit about me and what I've done here. So I started working at the Magnes about 2 years ago, as Francesco said, as an undergraduate research apprentice. And my first assignment or task was the cataloging of this collection of Yiddish books that were all published in California. So you see this book here with the dog. It's the book that's in this case. It's called Vavik, and it's a children's book that was published in Los Angeles in the 1950s by Haver Paver, who was a socialist organizer. I think it's a really great example of Yiddish literature in Los Angeles because it shows that there was children's literature in Los Angeles in the mid-20th century, which meant that there was a readership that read, like a young readership of Yiddish literature in the mid-20th century, which is really exceptional. And I've also cataloged Yiddish sheet music. You have an example of that here, which has been really exciting because there are a lot of different spellings of everything in Yiddish sheet music, which poses a big problem to the cataloger. And so I've cataloged these things, but I've done more than just cataloging them and putting in data. I've also digitized a lot of sheet music, and I also made this online map, Findery, which you guys will see in a little bit, that puts these Yiddish books in the context of Los Angeles. But I'm not really the first person to do some sort of like digital humanities mapping project for Jewish history in Los Angeles. There's this project called Mapping Jewish LA, which is a partnership between the UCLA Library and USC. And it's this sort of like online thing. They have a series of websites, and they say that it's a multimedia digital archive of Los Angeles. And they use this platform called HyperCities, which is run through Google Earth, that allows you to look at specific points in a map in specific periods of history. And it's sort of cool because they use historical maps. So they have this thing on Boyle Heights, and it takes you through a lot of the locations that are commonly associated with Boyle Heights. So Cantor's Deli, or There's a nursery, the Julia Ansinger Nursery, and it shows these points on their historical map, their historical location, and they share memories that people have of these locations and some sort of historical background. But the HyperCities platform has been discontinued by most browsers, and I think it sort of is hard to use, and so I found it really frustrating to use, and I was like, why is it so hard to access this information? And they also really don't touch on language or, I guess, the breadth of the Jewish experience in Los Angeles. In the Boyle Heights exhibition, they talk about Yiddish, but not in any significant way. They don't really talk about Yiddish literature. They have some other cool exhibitions if you're interested in Jewish Los Angeles. They have some stuff on Iranian Jews in Los Angeles, some stuff on different architects, or they have one on Jewish grocers. And they're really cool to look at because it does show the Jewish history of Los Angeles, but I think it's really critical to look at language as a feature of the Jewish experience, and that's why I am moving forward with Yiddish on the map. They do have this project that's coming up, and it's by this woman, Carolyn Luce, she just got her PhD at UCLA, and she is the only other person that I know of in the world who does Yiddish in Los Angeles. She wrote her dissertation on the Bakers Union in Boyle Heights, and you can see here that she's starting this project to make a digital anthology of Yiddish works that were published in California, in Los Angeles. And so that's really exciting, but it is a work in progress, and I cannot show you a map of it because they have not made one yet. But luckily, I made a map of Yiddish in Los Angeles, so it's not a work in progress. It is a work that is right here, and I'll show you right now. Once this goes next. Hold on. Oh, here we are. So here we see this map that I made. And I made this map on this website called Findery, which is this website where you can annotate places in the real world by leaving notes attached to a specific geographic location. And it's different than Google Maps, and that it's like a social media website where your note is situated in the context of everyone else's notes. So if we look here, I make these notes, and the notes include all the sort of basic catalog information. So they'll have the title in Yiddish and in transliterated English. They'll have the author, the editor. And what I did is I went through and I looked for addresses. So out of a collection of 99 books, about 15% included authors' addresses. And that's because a lot of the writers in Los Angeles were self-published, so that's the address they had to list. And about 10% included the printing press, or the printing house that printed them, which is also interesting because that tells us who had Hebrew type in Los Angeles. There are real material concerns when it comes to printing books, especially Yiddish books, so it's important to think about that. So anyway, there are these notes, these pins that I put up on the map, and so it'll have the title, if sometimes there's like really interesting cover art. All of these books are also online, so all of these notes also link to their archive.org webpage, which is where you can read these books online. So not only can you see them on a map, but you can also read them in the comfort of your own home. So it's really exciting to have all of this information accessible online. But what's really interesting about this is that you see this work in the context of Los Angeles and everything that Los Angeles is. So we see this map right here. And that pin, and so this is California Schriften, which was a journal that was published to commemorate 100 years of Jewish life in Los Angeles. So it celebrates from 1854 to 1954. But in the same area, so you can see right here, right, this is Grand Park. So City Hall is two blocks away. A little bit off the map, like around here, is where the California sushi roll was invented. I think over here is the building where it's a very popular building, but most famously, the Showdown in Blade Runner was filmed there. There's a Japanese novelty store in the area, and there's an image of Third Street, which is here. The pin is a little bit off the map. I think it's around here. An image of Third Street in the 1950s. So by putting these books on this map, we really see that these books exist in a broader context. They don't exist just as Yiddish literature, but they exist as part of LA's history and part of the map of Los Angeles, quite literally. So that's really exciting, and that's one really cool thing that we can see from this map. But there are other things we can see from this map. So if I put all these pins, these are all of the author's addresses that were listed in the books that I've collected. And so you see that there are two clusters. There's one in eastern Los Angeles, but notice the lack of books in Boyle Heights, which I'll explain or attempt to. And then there's also a cluster in western Los Angeles. So when most people, I tell people I do Yiddish in Los Angeles, they say, oh yes, Boyle Heights, the Lower East Side of Los Angeles. Oh wait, one more thing. This is all the printing houses, and they're all in downtown, which is separate from those two communities. Anyway, so when I tell people I do Yiddish in Los Angeles, they think that I do Boyle Heights, because that's where a lot of the Eastern European immigrants moved at the beginning of the 20th century. So from about 1900 to 1920, there were a lot of immigrants into Boyle Heights, which is right here. I thought it'd be cool to include a historical map. But Boyle Heights, although it was like a really big hotspot of Yiddish culture, it's very different from the east side of Los Angeles, and it really was a unique Los Angeles experience for these people that moved there. So Boyle Heights is not like the Lower East Side for several reasons, and this is laid out by Carolyn Luce in her dissertation, and she says that it was a small Jewish population, so even at its peak in the 1930s, there were only 50,000 people, or 50,000 Jews. And something unique about Boyle Heights is also that there were no restrictive covenants. So in a lot of other parts of Los Angeles, there were restrictive covenants that didn't allow Black people or Mexican people to live there. Sorry, I'm like, I have a cough. but in Boyle Heights, there were no restrictive covenants. So it was really ethnically diverse. And we see here this picture from a public school that had Japanese, Russian, Armenian, Jewish children all in the same school, which is not what would have been the case in the Lower East Side, where Jews lived in these ethnic enclaves in very, very strong ethnically Jewish centers. Furthermore, in Boyle Heights, there was no large-scale manufacturing, there were no sweatshops, so Jews were not in the lower class as much as they were on the Lower East Side. And this was particularly upsetting for them, because they had come and they wanted to replicate the sort of Eastern European radicalism that depended on them being the proletariat. So they come and they relocate and they're in Boyle Heights, but they're no longer lower class, and the same sort of arguments they made were no longer spitting. So they really had to adapt to the sort of new environment and the new condition in Los Angeles. So here, I have these pictures, and I think it's really great because we have the school and the PTA from the same year. So this is the Arbeiterring school, and the Arbeiterring is a socialist group. sorry. So give me one second. Okay. So they're a socialist group, and so as I said, all these Eastern European immigrants came to Los Angeles. They attempted to replicate their radicalism, but then they were confronted by the multiculturalism, right? And so what we see is this tendency of, thank you, these groups to stray from the national and international platforms, which really called for like Yiddish socialist organization and really staying within the Jewish community. But in Boyle Heights, a lot of these organizations branched out and they started to create multi-ethnic coalitions. And as a result of that, the Yiddish element of their politics sort of disappeared. So that's sort of a big feature or a big reason why Yiddish sort of disappeared in Boyle Heights, is because it existed in this multi-ethnic context, and that context really challenged it and forced. There was like this tension between creating an ethnic community and becoming American. And ultimately, they chose to become American, and even American socialism is different from Jewish socialism. And that's really the story we see in East LA. But that only explains half of the map. And there's this whole other group in West LA that no one has written about, but they published prolifically. So why? Why are all these addresses in Western Los Angeles if East LA is supposed to be the hotbed of Yiddish culture? Oh wait, I'm going to keep it here for 1 second. I have some answers. So in East LA, they're mostly like socialist organizers, right? So I imagine during the 1920s, 1930s, 1940s, they don't want to be like advertising where they live if they're writing, you know, communist propaganda. So that sort of seems like an obvious reason as to why there are no addresses in Boyle Heights. And also, most of the publishing done in Boyle Heights is like institutional or organizational. So like the Arbeiterin will publish and they'll list like the Arbeiterin. But, excuse me, in West LA, what you see mostly is authors are self-publishing, or they publish from these things called book committees, which are like groups of friends that will get together and publish a writer. So they don't have a publishing house to list, because there are no publishing houses, so they list their addresses. And so this map really shows that Boyle Heights is not the only site of Yiddish culture in Los Angeles, and that West LA was really home to a group of some cultural organizations and Yiddish writers that really were not interested in politics, but were interested in promoting Yiddish culture and Yiddish literature and the Yiddish language. And the foremost of these organizations is the LA Yiddish Culture Club, which was founded in 1926. They organized all sorts of events, all sorts of Yiddish events. So here we see they organized a Jewish community breakfast celebration in honor of Mr. and Mrs. Shlomo Ash. So they had visiting lecturers such as Shlomo Ash. They also had local writers. They hosted holiday events, writers' evenings, book and literature exhibitions. It was really a site for Yiddish writers and Yiddish artists to come and promote their work where they might not have had space to in Eastern Los Angeles. And they really wanted a many-sided, broad cultural activity. And they were ready to work with other cultural organizations, but they were a little bit wary of political organizations because they thought they were a little bit too fervent in their beliefs, and they thought that that might jeopardize their success. So we have here, this is from the first edition of their periodical Heshbon, which was started publication in 1946 on their 20th anniversary to commemorate their moving into a new building. So we have this paragraph here, which I'm sure you can read, but they're talking about how there was all this political tension, and really this group came out of all of that tension and decided that the way to preserve Yiddish culture was to be nonpartisan, that to preserve Yiddish culture was to not be bound up in politics. Their main goal was on preserving and promoting language. And so from the same essay, it was by Itzik Friedland, who I'll show you really quick. He's this guy, I Friedland. He's our buddy. He was the editor of Heshbon for many years. So he wrote that on the issue of language, that their goal is not to fetishize Yiddish. They don't want to make it special or fetishize it. They just want to use it. And they say that we want to use Yiddish in all of our activities and maintain Yiddish in a pure Yiddish environment, but not fetishize it. And they recognize like the difficulty of doing that, especially and with such secularization and such Americanization. But I think they did it pretty successfully, because Heshbon was published up until 2008. So there was Yiddish readership and Yiddish publishing in Los Angeles for half a century. And they said that they didn't want to draw from political or political beliefs or movements, but they said that they would draw from geistic culture, which is intellectual, spiritual, cultural. It's really hard to sum it up in one word in English. But really removed from politics, he says, we'll never ask you for your passport here. So it was really a space where people didn't have to worry about their political beliefs or where they came from, and they could just like appreciate their culture and their shared culture. So because they featured works from both sides of the spectrum, the left called them right and the right would call them left. So they occupy this sort of tenuous position, but their answer, and I figured we have to have Yiddish in this talk because it's about Yiddish, and it felt wrong to not have any Yiddish, so I'm going to read this for you if that's okay. So his answer to everyone, he says, Unser Antwort zu allen Menschen ist Kedere Gewehr und es euch ist der Selbige. Der LA Yiddischer Kulturclub ist Gewehr ist und ich hoffe, wird weiter absorbiert, nicht recht sozialist und Zionist und nicht link kommunistisch. Der Kulturclub wird dieses Ist anführen mit seiner überparteiischen Kulturtätigkeit, helfen und stützen alles, was es Yiddisch, national und kulturell, helfen heute die Yiddische Kulturaspirations, helfen der Heuven der Yiddischen Kulturmasse und frei sein die Interessen von die Yiddische Volksmassen, wo und in welcher Land sie sollen mit sein. So, what did he say? It's all Yiddish to me. So what he said was, our answer to everyone is always the same, it's always been the same, and it will continue to be the same. that the LA Yiddish Culture Club is, was, and I hope it will continue to be, not right, socialist Zionist, and I love that the right of Jewish politics is socialism, and not left, communist. But the Culture Club will continue to lead a nonpartisan cultural activities and help to support everything that is Yiddish, national, cultural, and hold high Yiddish cultural aspirations, elevate the Yiddish cultural condition, and drive the interests of the Yiddish folks' masses, whoever and wherever they are. So, their answer is always the same, but not quite. So in the second edition of Heshbin, they print nearly the exactly same essay, and here we see almost the exactly same answer. It reads almost exactly the same, but this edition came out in 1951, 3 years following the creation of Israel, so we do see their politics change a little. So everything is the same until we get down here, and he says, Natürlich ist die Etablierung von unserer jüdischen Meluche Yisroel per uns wie vor dem Rov Minyan Ubnonim von jüdischen Volk a groß historische Geschehnis, welchem wir halten vor sehr heilig und stark inspirierend dick. I really love that word. So what he says is pretty much, okay, we're not left social, or not left communist and not right socialist. He drops the socialist, or the Zionist after the socialist in this paragraph. And he says that Israel is something that they will defend and support. And this is the same year, I don't know if any of you saw the botanical exhibition here at the Magnes. They had it in the hallway over there last year. But in 1951, that exhibition was featured at the LA Yiddish Culture Club. So we can see that their politics do change in the post-48 era in favor of Israel and in favor of Zionism. So I thought it would be wrong if I'm going to talk about the LA Yiddish Culture Club in this map of Yiddish Los Angeles talk to not show a map of the LA Yiddish Culture Club. And they had many locations. So here we see a map of where they were for various points. So their original location in 1926 was a house in Echo Park. In 1930s, they moved onto the Sunset Strip. But the construction of the Hollywood Freeway changed the area a lot. So we see in 1946 that they moved, so this is the Hollywood Freeway, they moved closer to it. They moved to their permanent location, which is still a building today, and it houses a Presbyterian church that conducts services in Korean and Spanish. So it's cool to see the changing linguistic atmosphere of Los Angeles, and even of one building, that the language of a building can change. And so they stayed there for a while, 1946 until 1973, when they moved in with the Zionist Institute of Jewish Education and Folk School. What I find really compelling about this map is that they keep moving west. And I know it's sort of a cliche, the idea of moving west and manifest destiny or westward movement, but here it is true that they do move west. They do assimilate more and more with each movement until their failure in 2009. So I thought that was a pretty cool thing to include. So they continued on their cultural activities up until the 21st century. And what I have, what is that? Does anyone know what that means? Oh, I have a really great video. Wait, I'm gonna see if I can get the internet to work. Oh, it's, yes. So this video that I really wanna show you is of their club president, is their club president delivering? Won't we present? That's so weird. Yeah, it does. But I want to. Okay. So it's of their club, the last club president, Lilke Nashner, who had survived six concentration camps. She settled in Los Angeles in the 1950s. She was the president of the club from 1991 until its end. She was a really strong woman. She said, "I breathe in Yiddish." And so here we have a poem written by a Los Angeles poet, Moshe Sklar. She's reading it. It's really great. It's a minute long. Please enjoy her. I think she's a really compelling woman.
Unser Poet Moshe Sklar in eine von seine Lieder, Jiddisch Klang. Oh nein, oh nein, Jiddisch Klang ist nicht vergangen. Es ist gerechter und gerein. Es ist Gedank von teures Land, von teures Gang, durch Freud und Pein, durch Finsternis zu Schein, und Wiedergang und Wiedergang, sollen wir umgehen, wie lange wir kennen.
So, the poetic argument is pretty strong here. I have a translation here in the next slide from Herschel Hartnan, and it's not quite the same. It's from another time she delivered the same poem as a speech. But pretty much what she's saying is Yiddish sound still exists, and we must preserve it and keep it going as long as we can. And they did. So here we see Moshe Sklar, the poet himself, holding the last edition of Heshbet, number 150, which is really a remarkable feat, because if you look at the history of Yiddish publishing in Los Angeles, often what you'll see is one or two editions and then a publication will fold. But they published 150 editions, and that's remarkable. They featured, it was like a very intellectual journal as well. It wasn't a low quality publication, it was very high quality. They featured writers from all over the world. Very well-known Yiddish writers lived in Los Angeles, like Esther Shumiacher, Peretz Hirschfein, and they wrote in Heshbin, and Moshe Sklar wrote in Heshbin. And really, I think what the failure of Heshbin amounts to is the failure of editors and the lack of editors in Los Angeles, which you see from the beginning in the West LA Yiddish community. They don't have editors to make their journals. Like, there are writers and there are people who will print it, but no one's there to edit it. So a lot of the time, the books that are published by these like book committees, right? By groups of friends. None of the friends like really knew how to edit. And Moshe Sklar, up until, so that's the beginning, right? Of not having editors. And we continue all the way up until the end. Moshe Sklar didn't train a successor. So when he got ill, there was no one to edit the journal. And without an editor, the journal sort of crumbled. It couldn't go on. So I think it really speaks to the importance of editors in literature, because really, that's what we see. So this might seem like Yiddish is over, like it's done for Yiddish in Los Angeles, but that's not really the case. I wanted to end on this map, which is of current Yiddish organizations and things to do related to Yiddish in Los Angeles today, just to sort of prove that Yiddish lives on. So here is the Plummer Park Yiddish. Hopefully, note first off that all of these are in West LA. So I think it's very striking that West LA Yiddish is really the place. So the Plummer Park Yiddish, they meet at this park every Sunday. I'm on their email list. I've never been, but one day, hopefully I will go. And they speak in Yiddish. So it's a group that meets every week. And in the Bay Area even, the speaking group meets every other month. So the fact that people are willing to get together once a week, every week, to speak Yiddish is really compelling. Hatikva Music is in Fairfax, and they have the largest selection of Yiddish sheet music. I don't know if it's in the world, but they certainly have a really sizable collection of Yiddish sheet music. Yiddishkeit is a great nonprofit. They organize all sorts of Jewish education programs. I went on a trip with them to Eastern Europe last summer. Lilken Majner, the woman who we saw read the poem, she was on their board up until she fell very ill. There's the SoCal Arbeiter Ring, which still functions and still holds events. And then the California Institute of Yiddish Language and Culture was founded by Miriam Corral, who also wrote in Heshbin. She was also a member of the LA Yiddish Culture Club. I think this organization, this institute, sort of took off where the Yiddish Club left off. So there is continuity, and it's a narrative that really deserves to be told. So that's all. Younger people do go. And without these places, there isn't a space for younger people to practice their Yiddish. So as my, for me as a learner, like, it's really essential to have spaces where I can speak Yiddish and hone my Yiddish skills. So even if I'm only speaking to people who are of a different generation, that doesn't diminish the quality of the teaching. Yeah. You just want to know, yeah. I mean, I think, yes, there is a new generation. I think they're dispersed. Like, I don't know many young people my age who do Yiddish in this area. I think there are fewer of us, certainly. But I think it really helps to have communities that support us. And the elder community is really, yeah. So I think they are mostly older, but they create a space where younger people can come in and learn, which is important. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
In the valley, there's a large Jewish community, and they have a lot of Jewish community centers as a center for the Jewish people in the areas. I know because I lived there, and my cousins who still reside in Sherman Oaks. Mm-hmm. And my cousin has a Yiddish group that come, they go to different homes, both in LA and at her place. Mm-hmm. And so they attempt to speak Yiddish as the group progresses.
Yeah.
So that there are other people who are Yiddish speaking, not in the center of the Los Angeles, but outside.
So when preparing for this lecture, I looked at the Plummer Park Yiddishists, you find out about their events on this website called Meetups, and they have a whole list of other events that they're doing, and there's like this laying cries, a reading circle that meets. It said they wanted to meet in Sherman Oaks. There wasn't a location yet, so I didn't put it on the map, but that's in the Valley, and they're reading Yiddish literature. Yeah. The Valley, I'm from the Valley, so it's very personal. I didn't know anything about Yiddish LA, and the Valley, I think, is like it's not as Yiddish as other parts of LA could be. It's much more secular, and yeah, that's the way it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you know about the Yiddish community and the speech in the 40s and 50s?
Okay, so I don't know much beyond that they existed, but I consider that a minor feat. I do know that there were books published there, and I could point you to books that were published there. I was actually just showing someone today two books that were published in Venice Beach, or one was a collection of poetry. If you look at the Findery map and you go, there is a location in Venice Beach, and that will link to the work, and you can read it on archive.org. So I don't know the answer, but I hope they just pointed you towards where you can find it. Yes, whoever wants to. Yeah, yeah.
First of all, thank you for a really comprehensive, wonderful talk. Those of us who know you have to hear bits and pieces about what you're doing. It's wonderful to see and hear it all come together. I was wondering about freshmen. How often did it appear and how many pages?
Yeah.
Comprised
okay.
On average? Or was it a set number of pages or did it vary?
Okay.
The different issues?
So I wish there was a simple answer. It says I think it's supposed to be annual or biannual, but the first edition came out in 1946. The second one came out in 1951. But other ones are spaced closer together. Some of them have two editions in one. It's not really a neat thing to look through. They're all around 150 to 180 pages, I would say. And they feature poetry, essays, sometimes artwork, not as often. A lot of times essays about what's going on in Jewish Los Angeles. So it's really a broad scope. And an interesting thing, even if you look through the table of contents, as you go on, you notice more and more, like after the writer's name will be a parenthesis, and it'll say where the writer is from. So the crowd that they're drawn from gets more and more international as time goes on, and I think that's because there are fewer local writers. So they really have to draw from a broader pool. So that answer, yeah, okay.
I found out recently that Leonard Nimoy, who's a fluent Yiddish speaker,
yes.
And in view of all the Jewish directors and actors in Hollywood, was Hollywood ever a center?
Yeah. So that's really interesting. And my hypothesis or like, argument about that is that, well, it's not mine, it comes from a lot of other sources. But in Hollywood, you do see a lot of Jews, but they're really interested in creating, not only becoming American, but creating the American dream. And that's what you see in Hollywood in the 1930s and 40s, is you have all these like Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe who had come from extreme poverty. They relocate and they are given this, like, they're in this wonderland and they really don't want to associate with Yiddish. They want to create something that's American and that is not attached to their history, that they don't want to think about. They're coming from a history of pogroms and persecution, and they really want to distance themselves from that. So no, my dad is always like, don't you think, like, they just, like, spoke Yiddish in their board meetings? And I'm like, no, like, I think they did not want to speak Yiddish. So, yeah.
I have two questions. Mm-hmm. So, was there any advertising in any of these, or was it supported by just
yeah.
the purchase price, the subscription price?
There's surprisingly little advertising. In Heshbin, there is some, but a lot of these books don't. But what they will have is, like, it'll say, like, the book committee. And it's not just one or two names, but there will be, like, lists of people who supported or donated money to create such publications. So, yeah.
Does somebody donate this collection to the museum, or is it just been sort of put together?
I would have. Francesco would know better than me.
If you have any questions, maybe you want to take them.
Okay, yeah.
I want to say something about it, please.
Okay. I think I saw Ethel first.
Is there a Hasidic Yiddish-speaking community in L.A.?
Yes.
And,
I mean, Fairfax is the center of, like, Orthodox Judaism in Los Angeles, and I'm sure they have some sort of minor print culture. I haven't seen any material from them because I think it runs in a different circle than the Yiddish material that I come into. But there is one. Yes.
I was going to ask if there was Yiddish theater in LA.
Yes. Actually, so one of the main things of the LA Yiddish Cultural Club was to support Yiddish theater. They had, I read in their first edition that they had a youth theater program. There is one of the editors ran the program. His name was Eliyahu Tenenholtz. I don't know if that name is familiar, but there was Yiddish theater. They wanted to support it. And they got youth involved in theater because I think they thought that would be a good way to get youth involved in the language and in the culture. So they would perform classical Yiddish theater. And he, I think in the essay, they said that, like, some of the kids who were in the theater group would go on to, like, do theater in the area. So, yeah.
The other part of my question is
whether
Jewish schools or
Yiddish schools. Okay, so the Arbeiter Ring School is one example, but I don't think it's on the same scale. Like, there were Jewish schools, but they might not have been Yiddish schools. So, especially in the post-1948 era. So we see, like, a lot of Zionist schools, but they were.
Yeah.
In Boyle Heights, there were certainly Jewish educations that were conducted in Yiddish. Yeah. I'm not as knowledgeable about education as I am other things, but okay.
How and when did you come to learn to speak and read Yiddish?
Yeah, so it's actually a funny story that I've told, like, a million times. So I was going to learn Spanish because I'm interested in the American West, but I was like, American West, Mexico, I should learn Spanish. But then, like, Spanish class was really stressful, and there were a lot of people. And I walked out of that class, and I was like, wow, that's awful. I can never go back in there again. So I was, like, trying to think, like, what language could I learn? And I thought Yiddish would be cool, and it was just, like, a great experience. And, like, the teacher I had, she was a grad student, she was really nice, and I've continued with great teachers. And it's a relatively easy language to learn. If you know the alphabet, grammatically it's very simple. The complexity is really in the cultural background in learning what all, because sometimes you'll be reading Yiddish and there'll be a word in Hebrew, or there'll be a Talmudic reference, and you're like, whoa, I don't know what that is. So, yeah, I started learning Yiddish here, and I've continued to study around the world. Functional language, let alone as a functional language in a multi-ethnic web. So, yeah. Any other questions? Cool.
Before we thank you, Erin, just an answer to that question and a general comment. I mean, I don't think I have to add a fact that this is a phenomenal presentation and work here has been really top-notch, so I think we'll agree on that. But it's also a testament to the power of archives. Yiddish books were collected by Magnes, and actually Aronansky went on to establish the National Yiddish Book Center, started working at Magnes in Berkeley. And so the idea was conceived in that work. And while collecting books that people had in their basements and didn't know what to do with, the archivists of the old Magnes started setting aside volumes that were printed in California as a discrete group. And I've been adding to that group as I was going through the material, so we ended up with about 90 volumes.
I think it's 98 or 99.
98, okay.
Almost 100.
And almost 100. And many of them are actually already in the UC library system, but they are really sprinkled across different libraries and repositories. And so we felt that it was important to keep them as a unit. They were conceived in a way, they were collected as a unit, and it actually having them all in the same place enabled this type of research and the flourishing that we've been seeing with Erin's work. So it's also this I mean, archives have this kind of time capsule potential, right? You know, they're sort of like a good type of ticking bomb, right? And you don't know when they go off. They may go off at some point with somebody with the fabulous green hair comes along and discover that I think Yiddish needs more people like you and the world needs more people like you. So I don't know about the whole world, but definitely the Jewish world comes to you. This is the catalog of the Magnes collection I represented in the series Hits.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much.